thank you very much to Steam Company for having the possibility to give this talk. With this topic, we move on the ice, because what is desirable and what is affordable? And is this what is desirable really effective? So this discrepancy we have, especially in most of the country, what we can afford to have a good quality, or how much is a society able to pay for 100% precision. What do we expect from the intraoperative X-ray and special C-arm? At first, visualization of bony structures, direct visualization. We want to identify critical anatomical regions. We want to reduce and decrease radiation. And this is a very important thing. We want to have an easy handling, handling and a flexible and various application. Of course, I can have a machine, a big, big machine, but never as a standalone, never, because it's unflexible. It's not easy to handle, of course, but easy to handle means and acceptable costs. You have to invest at least 1 million, not included the big operation room you need, and looking for the most hospital you have. It's very easy. You go to the administration and say, okay, I need a $1 million or €1 million machine. Perhaps he will say, maybe. But if you say, we have to restructure all our buildings that cost at least 3, 4, or 5 million, then he will say, goodbye. But this is not the main topic. The main topic is that the quality is the most decisive point. It's clear. But can we achieve this quality also by cheaper means? So, visualization of bony structures, identification of critical anatomical regions, and reduced radiation. This is safety and quality features. And one example is the most important structure in cervical spine besides the cord, of course, the artia vertebralis. And you know that there are a very high variation of this vertebra. Up to 15 to 20% on all normal persons have a variation, and there are incidents of about 3 to 4%. They have only a unilateral artia vertebralis or a different supply. And here you see an 81-year-old man fall at home with a dense fracture. We make always in this patient preoperative CT angiogram, and you see here very precisely. There's the artery, and you recognize the problem. What is with my screw I want to introduce there? And here you see a CT scan picture, and where we have a high riding artia vertebralis. And this structure we want to identify during our operations. And this is the operation later done. The key problem in spine surgery is visualization. Critical zones. I repeat me, concerning the vertebral artery or the cord space. And you see here, this is the optimal place in an FND fracture that we don't hurt any important structures. This is a critical zone in spine besides the upper cervical spine. This is the upper thoracic spine, especially in the slim patient we have. Slim, we don't have more and more obese patient. And it's a catastrophe if I have a 2D imaging. And maybe that you have a good picture here, but in the AP view, there may be worth pictures looking for the pedicles. Our experience in spine imaging and navigation. We started almost 15 years ago with a CT-based navigation, also with Brain Lab, which is really also an excellent company concerning navigation. And you see all the picture my pre-speaker has shown to you, and you see, but this has been based on CT data. We used it also for anterior, not for posterior. I agree, for posterior pedicle, I don't need a navigation. But for anterior, you see, we could, by anterior navigation, we could exactly place our instruments by this small cut, and you see, this is an intraoperative picture, and we see where we are with our instruments, and we can reduce the posterior fragment. We use it also especially for the upper cervical spine, where it's very helpful. And you see here what the placement of a CT screw, a C2 screw. You see here the picture that was a surface matching. But this has been 15 years ago. And we also use it when we made an en bloc resection of in tumor, like this was a tumor, an HCC tumor in a 49-year-old patient. But the disadvantages. You need a preoperative CT, and you need a preoperative work on data, and that makes it difficult. And the most important thing is, during the positioning of the patient, you change the patient, and sometimes you can't rely on the CT-based data you get the day before. So this was the reason that we shift for the 3D fluoroscopy. So the time is not so much with the first generation of 3D, with a 60-second scan time. Of course, you have the learning curve, that you avoid collisions, that you are familiar with the imaging intensifier. But what you get is a real-time presentation. And what is very important, you have a mobile instrument, a mobile thing. You can switch the operations, and I will show you also more indications. And for me, 3D and navigation are twins. The single one is fine, but if you make one and one, that means imaging, 3D, and navigation is not two, it's three. So especially for me, the indication for the upper cervical spine, so for the cervical thoracic junction, for the upper middle thorax, and especially the pelvis and the sacrum is the keystone of the spine, and we use it very often also for the sacrum. And here you see the 3D imaging, and this was the first generation of the machine, and the quality depends on the body mass index and, of course, of the bone mineral density. And this is a 23-year-old patient, nothing special. But if you have a higher body mass index, you realize the structure, but it could be improved, and especially if you have a severe osteoporosis, the quality is reducing. Nevertheless, you can identify sufficiently what your structures are doing and your things are putting in. And we also published it some years ago, our first patients with 451 screws in posterior intervention of the cervical and thoracic spine. And you see, there was not 100%. And you see, there was the same rate of repositioning of the implants. We also looked for the cervical spine, which is more different and difficult. And you see, there has been some crucial screws like the Margal, Massa, and the Jude screws. And although we found there very good clinical results. And what is important? Of course, sometimes you can have perforation. But the most important thing is that you have no vascular and neurologic complications due to your operations. And no revision surgery was needed. Nevertheless, I agree, grade 1 is not 100%. But in our community, grade 1 is accepted to be, from the biomechanical side, sufficient. And the same was published from a Japanese group also 6 years ago, that 3D fluoroscopic assisted cervical pedicle screw insertion is absolutely okay. And some cases. You see a 55-year-old patient, car accident, and you see the picture, and you see here the Effendi type, which is also a certain instability because including the base on the dents, so it's unstable. We always make a pre-op angiogram, and this is a minimal invasive procedure with the navigation. And you see this picture. It's a 3D mobile C-arm, and you can identify exactly the position of the screw, and you see how you avoid to tackle the vertebra artery, and even in the pedicles, you see a nice view, which gives you very good feeling. And this is the intraoperative view. And what is decisive? That you not only control the process of introducing the implants. Decisive is that you can make an intraoperative control. This is, for me, the most important step, which may become a legal keystone. Today, I'm not allowed to say you have to have a navigation, but we are moving in this direction. And you see, the screw is nicely placed And you see, you can control it intraoperatively, and I believe it's a good quality. And this is postoperatively, the CT scans control, and you see it's not far away, but it's sufficient, and this is a patient with a minimal invasive procedure. Next case, 81-year-old with an unstable, unhappy triad of the upper cervical spine, and you see also the very high-riding vertebral artery, and again, you need a navigation to identify the correct angle of the insertion point. This can vary very much, and you see especially the C1 screw was decisive in this patient with a C0 and C4 fixation. 38-year-old patient with a pseudarthrosis of the dense fracture. You see there are cysts in it, unstable, and we have to use the C1 screw, which is not so easy, and again based on the 3D. And you see, get good pictures in combination with navigation. You can identify the important structures, avoiding neurologic or vascular damage. But 6 months later, in spite of the good operation, there was a failure. We can analyze it, but it's not the time. And again, we could make the revision surgery with a 3D imaging from SEAM and the brain lab navigation. And again, you see the exact pictures, and which makes it quite easy. You have to be experienced a spine surgeon, but it makes it easier. And of course, in this situation, we had to change to a Margal screw and a modified gully fixation. And again, the intraoperative control, which is very important, though, that you have a correct placement. This was the first screw, and this is the second screw in the revision surgery, and this is a post-op control. And again, you see there are the nerve roots, and there's a vertebral artery. You don't have only 1 or 2 or 3 millimeter place, and therefore, I'm convinced that it's a must to have any, maybe what you want, but you need a support by imaging in combination with the navigation. This is a post-op. Osteomyelitis of C1, and these are patients where you don't get any 2D picture. That's difficult to have here a picture in these patients, and this is the stuff, you know, this is a decompression and of this osteomyelitis of the upper cervical spine. And of course, there was a picture, and I show you also borderline pictures in this osteoporotic bone. It's not so easy, and there is a step downwards concerns the quality of the picture, but nevertheless, it's quite reliable. Again, you see, this is again good pictures showing the entrance point here of C1, and this is a post-op and the intraoperative protocol, which is very important. No patient in my institution has leaves the operation or the operation theater without any intraoperative control. This is the patient. We also published this in the Operative Techniques of Orthopedics last year. Intraoperative control, very important. 73-year-old patient with an unstable flexion-distraction fracture. And therefore, in this junction, you realize that we have a problem to identify. You have to move the imaging intensifier. This is very difficult, but with and to identify whether you how to remove the disc and to place the optimal screw. And then it can be helpful if you have the reduction postoperatively with a 3D scan, and you can identify the correct reduction and the correct placement of the screws. And this is a post-op. Thoracic spine, very important, very important. And we also looked for this patient. We made a prospective study. You see almost 400 screws, and there was also no severe complication. We have presented this in the German Trauma Congress last year, and these are the data. I don't want to repeat. Almost 1,500 screws we had looked, but it was a retrospective study, not a case. And here you see a case. It's a T5 fracture, which is, according to my opinion, unstable. It's a fate to believe that these mid-thoracic fractures are stable. When they are more unstable than you believe. Therefore, these are indications for operation. And you see, this is the diameter of this pedicles. And again, this is there is a borderline. But nevertheless, you can identify in the post-operative or intraoperative control whether your screws are correctly, and you don't create a secondary damage. And you see that with a 3D fluoroscope, this is published this year in the Neurosurgical Spine, that with a 3D, you get a significantly better placement of the screws. No 2D, but always in combination with the navigation. And I believe that all the three speakers are here on the common sign. What do we expect from the intraoperative 3D? Now I have talked with you about safety and quality. But to convince in my institution, I can come to my nurses and to my doctors say, oh, we improve the safety and the quality. But then they get a big machine. It needs half a year before they understand the machine. And to move the machine, or not to move. So easy handling is a very crucial point to convince my co-workers to use it and to use it flexible in these various applications and acceptable costs. That means feasibility and logistic features. Cost effectiveness, Christian Kretek published it some years ago. It was very early publication, but it's only one of the few publications you can see in the literature which 7 years ago concluded that the costs are high, there may be a financial benefit using this. And now, there's an important point. What we have learned with a 3D, because it's flexible. Sometimes in the spine OR, I don't need it. But my pelvic guys, or even as a pelvic surgeon, I need it. So here you see a pelvic ring fracture in this elder patient, which we like to stabilize these IS screws, and we have malposition of the IS screws up to 20%. So the intraoperative 3D helps us also for other indications, and you see this is a post-op CT control, and we are using it more for others. One of my group has got the prize of the arthroscopic society for using a 3D in other indications, here shoulder and proximal humerus fracture. And we published it in the German paper where we use this 3D. And you see that we have also a high rate of malpositional screws in this. It's not for spine, but I know that many spine surgeons are doing also others or are working in institution where you have to deal with other injuries too. And you see this is now introduced in my clinic as a routine protocol. So we need not only one 3D, one expensive machine, we need more that we can move from one OR to the other. And you see, this is a protocol where we control it. What do you think about these 3D pictures concerning quality, CT? Now, these are the new pictures from the new 3D, the new generation. And you see here, it's a quality next step, that it has CT quality. And this is a new C-Vision 3D, which we get now on the market. And you see again here, cervical spine. And you recognize that there's another dimension of quality. And with this quality, I believe you can handle each problem. My conclusion. 3D fluoroscopy has become an easy handling and, very important, reliable tool in preoperative diagnosis, very important intraoperative controlling, intraoperative navigation, remember TWIN, visualization and navigation, and postoperative controlling. And it's very comfortable, not only for spine surgeons, but maybe for more indications for neurosurgeon trauma and also orthopedic surgeons. Thank you very much.